presents this unabridged recording of The Song of Lewis Carmichael, written by Sofie Laguna and read by John Voce. For Sonny and Milo. Chapter 1. Matthew Zajac lay in his bed in his room at the top of the stairs. He was surrounded by library books. Magnetic North, Into the Ice, Journey to the Farthest North, and Animals of the Arctic. He opened Animals of the Arctic at a double-page spread of The Arctic Wolf. The white wolf was cut in half by the crease between the pages. Matthew smoothed his hands down over the animal's golden eyes, its rough fur. The Arctic wolf lives in the boreal forests, Matthew read. As the frozen ground prevents the Arctic wolf from digging a den, it typically makes its home in a cave. He glanced up through the window above his bed at the starless sky outside. The moon was full, and he could see rows of triangular rooftops belonging to the many other houses just like his. In the night skies of the Arctic, you could see the northern lights, clouds of pink and green and purple light that had come all the way from the sun, spiraling like the patterns on a shell. Matthew rolled onto his side and opened Magnetic North. When he read about the Arctic, he entered another world. He turned to a picture of wide grassy plains at the foot of a range of snow-capped mountains. The picture was labelled Arctic Tundra in the Summertime. Matthew ran his fingers over the words. Arctic winters are long and cold, while summers are short and cool. The average Arctic winter is minus 34 degrees. He lay back on his pillow. The northernmost point on the Earth was the North Pole, a place separate from the grassy plains, the mountains, and the forests of the Arctic. The North Pole was a land made only of ice, which floated on the Arctic Sea. Water that you could walk on. A land that never stopped moving. Matthew put down his books and switched off his reading lamp. Downstairs, he could hear his parents talking about him.
It's because you let Matthew... You don't make him... But I have tried to make him...
If there was some way, don't you think I'd find it?
Their anxious voices rose and fell in waves. How many nights had he fallen asleep to the sound? Matthew squeezed his eyes shut tight and saw the Arctic tundra filled with poppies and cotton grass and bearberries. He watched as the summer skies darkened and the snows began to fall, covering the trees of the boreal forests, the tall and jagged mountains. When winter was at its coldest, minus 40 degrees in the North Pole, he would sleep. He was woken that night by tapping at the window. Matthew rubbed his eyes and sat up in his bed. Tap, tap, tap. He wiped the foggy glass with his hand and saw a bird on the ledge outside. A black bird. A crow. What was a bird doing here in the middle of the night? Tap, tap, tap. The bird was tapping at the glass with its beak. Did it want to come inside? Was it cold? Matthew opened the window.
At last, the bird said.
Matthew shook his head. Was he dreaming?
The bird said, I didn't think you were ever going to open the window.
Matthew couldn't speak. What was happening?
Matthew?
Was he really trying to talk to a bird?
I am Lewis, Lewis Carmichael, said the bird.
Lewis?
We met today. You shared your cake with me. You remember me, don't you?
Matthew did remember. The bird from the park. The bird with the broken wing.
Chapter 2.
Earlier that day, Matthew's mother had been waiting for him as he'd come down the stairs for breakfast as usual. She'd been standing at the stove.
Good morning, she said. Hungry?
Need your strength, son. Growing boys need to eat,
his father said, buttering toast at the kitchen table.
What would you like to do today, Matthew?
His mother asked. Matthew had shrugged, had seen his mother glance at his father.
Why don't you take your bike to the park and get some fresh air?
His father asked.
There might be someone down there for you to play with. You know, kick the ball around.
Yes, Dad. I'll pack some muffins,
his mother said, her smile hopeful. Matthew had listened to the creak of his bicycle wheels as he'd pedaled down the road to the park. If only a sister would come along, or a brother, he thought, pushing down on the pedals. Someone else to give his parents what they wanted. His bike bumped unsteadily over a pothole, and he frowned. Matthew wobbled when he rode too slowly. That would drive his father crazy.
Get some speed up, son! Come on, Matt! Straighten her up!
When he came to the park, Matthew had leaned his bike against the bench, taken off his backpack, and sat. In the distance, he saw Mariel and Lee and Adam coming up from the slope that led to the river. They were in his class, and he often saw them together at school. He wondered what they did down there by the river. You weren't allowed. The school said it wasn't safe. His parents said it too. But Mariel and Lee and Adam were always going there. They seemed to be searching for things, and they were often muddy, climbing the rocks, the trees, looking up close at things they found. Mariel carried a bucket. What went into it, Matthew wondered. Taking his book from his pack, Journey to the Farthest North, Matthew turned to a picture of a sailing ship with a woman at the helm. She was wearing a heavy padded coat with a hood and was looking through binoculars out to sea. Matthew read the words underneath the picture. Dr. Juliana Rossi travels to the North Pole. Dr. Juliana Rossi, Matthew whispered. He looked up and noticed Mariel watching him and felt his face turn hot. Why was she looking? Lee, too. What did they want? Matthew returned to his book. Dr. Juliana Rossi has given us a new understanding of the Arctic with her magnificent pictures. He turned the page and saw a flock of snow geese in migration. Snow geese migrate in large numbers for over 3,000 miles to warmer shores, he read. At that moment, Matthew glanced up and was surprised to see a black crow sitting on the back of the bench beside him, as if it too was looking at the pages of Journey to the Farthest North. Hello, said Matthew. The bird hopped from the back of the bench to the seat and then onto the ground. As it pecked at the dirt, Matthew noticed that one of its wings dragged like it might be broken. He pulled the apple muffin his mother had made for him from his pack, tore it in half, and tossed one half to the ground. The bird looked at him, its head angled quizzically, then came closer, pecking at the muffin. Matthew looked up to the monkey bars, where a group of kids were swinging from the parallel ladder, climbing the knot ropes, somersaulting over the rails. He turned back to the picture of Dr. Juliana Rossi, binoculars in hand, in Journey to the Farthest North. Was it in Matthew's body that stopped him swinging and somersaulting and climbing with the others? Why could they do it but not him? He glanced down at the black crow bobbing about the bench. It had eaten all of the muffin. "More?" Matthew asked under his breath. The bird's eyes glinted. Matthew had thrown the bird the second half of his apple muffin, then stood up. "I'd better be going," he said. As much as his parents wanted him to improve his physical skills, they grew worried if he was gone too long. Chapter 3. Now, Matthew frowned at the black bird from the park sitting on his window ledge. Though he remembered the bird, he would never have believed it could speak. Was he hearing things?
"I do remember, yes, but..."
"But what?"
"Birds can't talk."
"Can't they?" said the bird. "Well, I am a bird, and I'm talking to you."
"Yes, but..."
"Matthew, look up." The bird hopped around and lifted its beak to the sky. "Up there." Matthew leaned out of his window. There, in the sky, was an enormous balloon, as big as a house, it seemed to Matthew. Its colours were glowing so brightly that it was as if the moon itself was caught inside the balloon. Orange, green, pink, yellow, blue, purple, great glowing vertical stripes. The balloon was attached to a large wicker basket, which was sitting on Matthew's roof.
"Am I dreaming?" he said aloud.
Who was he asking? Was he asking the bird?
"No, of course not."
The bird gave him a short, sharp peck on the arm.
"Ouch! You felt that?" said the bird.
"Yes, yes," Matthew rubbed his arm.
"You wouldn't feel it in a dream, would you?"
Matthew didn't know. He was confused. What was happening?
"You showed me your book today, and I thought you might like to go on an adventure, the way your scientist did, your Dr. Juliana Rossi, A Journey to the Farthest North."
"That's where you want to go?" Matthew asked.
"Don't you?"
"But it's impossible."
"Why do you say that?"
"The North Pole is 6,922 nautical miles from here."
2 days in the balloon, by my calculations," said the bird.
2 days to fly by balloon to the North Pole? Not possible. Matthew leaned out the window. The cold hit his face, burning his nose and cheeks, cutting through the fabric of his pajama top. The balloon swayed in the sky.
"Come on," said the bird. "We need some nautical miles underway before dawn."
The balloon tugged on its ropes, and the wicker basket moved upwards across the roof. Matthew rubbed his eyes.
"Matthew, my name is Lewis Carmichael, and I have found us a way to travel to the Arctic. Come on!
The bird sounded frustrated. Matthew thought, if I am dreaming, what does it matter if I say yes to the bird?
You want to see it, don't you? The North Pole? Reindeer, polar bears, all that?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.